Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. Today, Ashley and John Russell tell about a company using sheep to control plant growth. Then, scientists map an insect brain. After that, Anna Mateo reports on a pregnancy study. And then, the lesson of the day. But first,
some American communities and universities have been experimenting with sheep and goats to keep plant growth under control. Along the Cumberland River near Nashville, Tennessee, visitors on boats watch the large buildings of the city in the distance. But they also can see something few expected: hundreds of sheep eating grass or grazing along the river.
Zach Richardson oversees the sheep. His business is called Nashville Chew Crew. Richardson said sometimes the boats will go out of their way to let passengers get a closer look at his sheep. The group of sheep can be seen grazing a few hundred meters away from places where many people live and work. The joy people get from watching sheep eat is partly why the creatures are becoming popular workers in some urban areas. Everybody that comes out here and experiences the sheep, they enjoy it more than they would someone with a leaf blower or a weed eater, Richardson said. Using sheep to control plants is not a new method, but more American communities are choosing sheep to deal with problems such as invasive species, wildfire risks, native plant protection, and to keep historic places in good condition. In 2017, Nashville's Parks Department paid for the Chew Crew to control unwanted plant growth at Fort Negley. The Union Army built the fort during the U.S. Civil War. Unwanted plants, or weeds, were growing between and along its stones. Tools like lawnmowers could easily damage the stones. Sheep now graze in an area of about 61 hectares of city property yearly, including in the historic Nashville City Cemetery. Jim Hester is Assistant Director of Metro Nashville Parks. Speaking about the sheep, he said, "It is a more environmentally sustainable way to care for the green space and oftentimes is cheaper than doing it with handheld equipment and staff." Dogs watch over the Chew Crew's sheep. The dogs spend their whole lives with the sheep and keep visitors and animals from getting too close. The group of sheep, or flock, is made up of hair sheep, a kind of animal that naturally releases its hair fibers and is often used for meat.
Santa Barbara, California, has been using sheep for about 7 years to protect land buffers that can slow or stop the spread of wildfires. The community loves the grazers, and it's kind of a great way of community engagement, said Monique O'Connor, open space planner for the city's parks and recreation. The grazed areas can change how fire moves, said Mark Vontillo, the wildland specialist for the Santa Barbara City Fire Department. Vontillo said that if a fire hits a grazed area, the fire behavior reacts drastically and drops to the ground. he added, that gives firefighters a chance to attack the fire. Some universities have tried using goats and sheep on their properties. In 2010, weeds were overtaking an area at the University of Georgia that was not used by students or staff. The weeds were pushing out native plants, said Kevin Kirsch, the school's director of sustainability. Rather than using chemicals or mowers, Kirsch said the university hired Jennifer Chandler to send in a herd of goats. Bringing the goats to the site was an alternative means of removing invasive plants in a way that was non-toxic to the environment and friendly to people, Kirsch said. At the time, Richardson, the owner of Chew Crew, was a student at the University of Georgia studying landscape architecture. He got the idea to create his own goat grazing business. The goats became the most popular four-legged creatures on campus, he said. Richardson, who moved his company to Nashville after finishing his studies, now prefers sheep over goats. Sheep have closer group ties and are not as likely as goats to climb and explore. I'll never own another goat, he admitted. It's like trying to fence in water. But sheep are not an answer for all cities and their lands, O'Connor said. We want to educate the public on why we're choosing to graze where we're grazing, she added. Hundreds of sheep can affect the environment by spreading seeds. The city of Santa Barbara does environmental studies before bringing in grazers, since the process can also affect birds. Throwing like 500 sheep into an area is a much larger impact on the land and those soils than our native herbivores would have, O'Connor said. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm John Russell.
A group of international scientists recently announced they had made a map of the whole brain of an adult fruit fly. They said the milestone would provide new knowledge about the brains of all animals, including humans. The research gives details of more than 50 million connections between 139,000 neurons, which are nerve cells in the brain of the fruit fly. The scientific name of the animal is Drosophila melanogaster. It is often used in scientific experiments, especially studies of nerve cells. The researchers wanted to find out exactly how the brain cells operate when they are healthy and normal. Sebastian Sung was one of the leaders of the research, which was published as a series of studies in Nature. Sung is a professor at Princeton University in New Jersey. He said, "You might be asking why we should care about the brain of a fruit fly. My simple answer is that if we can truly understand how any brain functions, it's bound to tell us something about all brains." The brain of a fruit fly is small, less than 1 millimeter wide. But some scientists are very interested in them. "It's beautiful," said Cambridge researcher Gregory Jefferis. The researchers created what they called a wiring diagram of an adult fruit fly. It is also called a connectome map. The goal was to create a map that shows how neurons connect to one another and how they operate. Similar research has been done with simpler forms of life. For example, scientists have mapped the brain of a worm called Caenorhabditis elegans. They have also mapped the neural material of the larval form of the fruit fly. But the adult fruit fly was more complex. The idea was to link the neural connections to the behavior of the animal. Mala Murthy was another co-leader of the research from Princeton. Murthy said, "One of the major questions we're addressing is how the wiring in the brain, its neurons and connections, can give rise to animal behavior." One of the studies in the series examined the brain circuits involved in walking. It discovered how flies halt. Another studied the fly's network of neurons associated with tasting, and also grooming circuits. These circuits are behind the behavior in which a fly uses its leg to remove dirt from antennae on its head. One of the studies examined how a fly processes motion and color information. And still another looked closely at how parts of the fly's brain were connected. That study discovered that a large group of neurons, called hub neurons, might help speed up the flow of information. The researchers created the map by following how both sides of the brain were organized and linked the circuits they identified to behaviors. They also identified classes of cells in the fly's brain and examined the chemical connections between neurons known as synapses. The international collaboration of scientists called Flywire Consortium carried out the research. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. When a brain scientist at the University of California, Irvine, got pregnant at the age of 38, she saw a rare chance. Neuroscientist Liz Krastel wanted to see how her brain changed while she was pregnant. Krastel was among a group of researchers who presented their findings in a new study. It offers the first detailed map of one woman's brain through the steps of pregnancy, also called gestation. Researchers say that motherhood affects nearly every part of the brain. The researcher studied the effects of pregnancy in only one person, Krastel. But their study has started a large international research project that aims to scan the brains of hundreds of women. The study could one day provide information about disorders like postpartum depression. Postpartum means after birth has taken place. Krastel said it has been a very long process. We did 26 scans before, during, and after pregnancy. She said some of the findings were very noteworthy, or in her words, remarkable. Krastel is co-writer of the study that researchers published in Nature Neuroscience in September. More than 80% of the parts of the brain studied had reductions in the amount of gray matter, where thinking takes place. This is an average of about 4% of the brain. This amount is nearly the same as the amount of reduction that happens during puberty. Puberty is the biological changes that cause a person to become a fertile adult. However, the researchers said the reduction is probably not a bad thing. It might mean that networks of interconnected nerve cells, called neural circuits, are preparing for a new time in a woman's life. The team began following Krastel shortly before she became pregnant through in vitro fertilization. During the pregnancy, and for 2 years after she gave birth, they continued doing MRI brain scans and blood tests to see how her brain changed. During this time, Krastel's sex hormones, like estrogen, increased and decreased. Some of the changes continued past pregnancy. Emily Jacobs is with the University of California, Santa Barbara, and was also a co-writer of the study. Jacobs said earlier studies had taken scans of the brain before and after pregnancy. But she said none had shown changes in the brain as they were taking place. Unlike past studies, this one centered on many inner areas of the brain, as well as the cerebral cortex, the outermost area, said Joseph Lonstein. He is a professor of neuroscience and psychology at Michigan State University and was not involved in the research. Lonstein said, "It is a good first step to understanding much more about whole brain changes that could be possible in a woman across pregnancy and postpartum. Research in animals has linked some brain changes with qualities that could help the animal care for an infant. The new study does not deal with what the changes mean in terms of human behavior." However, Lonstein said that it does describe changes in brain areas involved in social cognition or thinking. This is how people act with others, for example, how they understand their thoughts and feelings. The researchers have partners in Spain, and they are developing what they call the Maternal Brain Project. The Anne S. Bowers Women's Brain Health Initiative and the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative support the project. The researchers say they hope scientists can use findings from more than one woman to predict problems such as postpartum depression. There is so much about the neurobiology of pregnancy that we don't understand yet, Jacobs said. She added that this is not because women and pregnancy are too complex. More is not known about pregnancy and the brain, she said, because biomedical sciences have historically ignored women's health. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
You are listening to the VOA Learning English Podcast. And you just heard the Health and Lifestyle Report from Ana Mateo. We have Ana here to tell us more about the report. Welcome, Ana.
Hello. Thanks for inviting me to your podcast.
Ana, how is this study of pregnancy different from others?
For this study on pregnancy, the research team began following one woman. That makes it different. But the main difference is that researchers looked at how her brain changed during her pregnancy. Earlier studies looked at changes in the brain before and after pregnancy, but not during.
Anna, what is the future of this sort of research?
The researchers are partnering with others to develop what they call the Maternal Brain Project. The researchers say they hope scientists can use findings from more than one woman to predict problems like postpartum depression.
Thank you, Anna, for all your good work on health and education issues.
Bye, and thanks for having me.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In a recent Lesson of the Day podcast, we talked about Anna trying to be a genie. That's spelled G-E-N-I-E. In Lesson 34 of the Let's Learn English series. A genie has special magical powers. Anna thinks these include the power to read people's minds. To read minds means to know what other people are thinking.
We should add that in Let's Learn English, Anna meets a genie who does have some magical powers. But this genie only gives Anna some special genie clothes. She does not give Anna magical powers.
Anna was dressing like a genie for Halloween, a popular tradition in the United States celebrated on October 31st. People dress as scary creatures such as monsters or ghosts, or as any other special thing or person.
Anna discovers she is not very good at reading people's minds. So at first, she uses the word might because she is not sure. But when Anna says might, this makes people worry about what will happen to them in the future. Let's listen to this part of Lesson 34.
Can you really read minds?
I might.
Well, today I will ask my girlfriend to marry me. What am I thinking?
Wait. Wait. You are thinking you might have a wedding very soon.
Might? Might? She won't say no. Will she?
No, no. She will say yes.
I will have a wedding, won't I?
You will. You will.
Thanks. I think.
Good luck!
Anna had to predict or say what she thinks will happen in the future.
You know, Lesson 34 of Let's Learn English made me think about predictions and about chance, which means how likely it is something will or will not happen. And it reminded me of two conversations I recorded with Faith Perlow, who writes Ask a Teacher and Everyday Grammar articles on the Learning English website. Faith and I talked about making predictions.
Did she try to read your mind?
No, she's not a genie, but she is a teacher, and we made the recording to explain some expressions.
Oh, now I'm curious. Let's hear it.
Okay. Here's our first conversation.
Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Faith.
So, Andrew, do you have any plans for the weekend?
I do. I'm going to play tennis tomorrow.
You are? I think it's supposed to rain.
Really? I thought it was supposed to be good.
Let me check my phone. Okay, so it says there's a 30% chance in the morning and 90% later in the day.
Well, I play in the morning, so those are pretty good odds. Though the odds of me winning are not very good.
Why? Are you playing with somebody really good?
Yeah, he's good. I can practice with him fine, but in a match, I have to play my best, and he has to play kind of poorly for me to have a chance. So it's very unlikely I'll win, but it's still super fun either way.
Well, it sounds like you have a 100% chance of fun.
That's right. As long as it doesn't rain.
And here's our second conversation.
So, Faith, I notice there really are a lot of ways to talk about what we think might happen in the future.
That's right. We're talking about what's likely to happen. So we talk about the odds or the chances.
Odds and chances are basically the same thing?
Yes. If we say, what are the odds of, or what are the chances of, we are asking how likely something is to happen.
And talking about the percent chance, math and science tend to use the word probability.
That's right. It's used a lot in the sciences and mathematics to talk more precisely about the chances.
So we can say something is probable or likely. Probable is an adjective. Or instead, we can say something will probably happen. Probably is an adverb. And we can talk about the probability of an event. Probability is a noun.
And I hope our listeners notice that we add the preposition of after the noun probability. We say the probability of something.
Just like we say the odds of something or the chances of something.
Well, Andrew, I hope this was helpful for our listeners.
Me too. Chances are, it was helpful for at least some people.
And what about your tennis game? How did it go?
Well, I said I was unlikely to win, and that prediction was correct.
But it was still super fun?
It was. But winning might be even more fun.
Ah, better luck next time.
Thanks. Though I think I need more than luck. I need to practice.
We all need to practice things we are learning, or things that take skill, especially when you're learning a language.
Right, like learning English.
Yeah, and you know, speaking of predictions, we can also talk about the word weather.
You mean the rain?
No, not that kind of weather, spelled W-E-A-T-H-E-R. I mean the other word, spelled W-H-E-T-H-E-R. Like when we want to know whether or not something will happen.
Yes, and here's a good detail for people learning English to notice. It's more common to say the word if than whether. For example, we typically say, I want to know if it's going to rain.
But we can use weather when we want to clearly state two or more different possibilities. For example, we might say, I need to know whether my car has a problem with its battery or with its engine.
So, whether you find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, or our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. We hope you have enjoyed the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast.
And thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.